My name's Alan. I'm here to...
You're here to change my sheets, dear.
Right, sorry. Today is my first day.
First day? And she had to bring a chart. Be nice, please. You'll also need to bring my medication at 3 o'clock.
Oh, right.
They just seem to be getting younger and younger, don't they?
Leave them alone, Louise.
I'm just saying. Charlie agrees with me, don't you, Charlie?
I think he looks sweet.
You think everyone looks sweet.
Miss Jeffrey? I was just wondering, are you the Esther Jeffrey who wrote Broken Petals?
Well.
Yes. Yes, I am.
I wasn't sure. We read Broken Petals in my modern literature class, but there was no information about you, so I wasn't sure if you were...
still alive.
Right. And then I saw you on my list this afternoon, and I just really wanted to say that I really loved your writing.
Good luck.
Thank you. Was there something else, dear?
My professor said you only published one novel.
That's right.
Well, why?
Oh, I don't know if your professor mentioned this, but my work was considered very controversial at the time it was published.
He said some things about it.
You have to remember, I was writing at a very different time. Books written about sex and suicide, books written by a woman, no less, were not exactly taken with an open mind.
So you just stopped writing?
No, no, I never stopped writing. I just stopped letting the public read my work.
That's never bothered you?
That's the question everyone seems to ask. Writing has always been something I've done for myself. My characters, the characters I create, they're for me. Letting the public read your work, you just set yourself up for disaster.
But isn't that the point of writing, to show the world through your eyes? How can you feel fulfilled knowing that no one will ever read your work?
Once I let someone read my book, they won't be mine anymore. The masses will interpret your work differently than you intended, and I just couldn't bear to see my characters torn apart by acid-quilled critics.
Don't you think you're being a little selfish? I mean, what's the point of writing if you refuse to share? I thought...
I really think I've had enough questions for one day. If you don't mind, I'd like to get back to my book.
I'm sorry, Miss Jeffrey. I didn't mean to... I'll just go now.
Call me Esther.
What?
Call me Esther. And don't forget my pills.
I won't. Esther?
Well, he's something, isn't he?
I don't like him.
You don't like anyone.
I like him.
You do?
Esther, what would happen to us if you let somebody else read our stories?
I don't know, Ruby. I think things would change.
Is that why you haven't let anybody read your stories?
Maybe. It's complicated. If I share your stories, you won't be mine anymore. I might never be able to talk to you again. You wouldn't want that, would you?
Not that I'm not grateful, Esther, but I, for one, would not mind getting out of this room.
Shut up, Louise.
I'm just saying. Ruby, would you like to learn how to Charleston?
Yes, please.
Come here, Paul.
Esther.
I know what you're going to say, Jack.
Are you sure the reason you don't publish our work is because...
Jack?
It's because you're afraid of what's going to happen to us when you do.
I'm old, Jack. Let me be perfect.
More pillows for you, Esther.
That's the fourth time he's been here this week.
He likes it here.
Thank you, dear.
Look what else I found.
What is it?
It's a newspaper clipping. It's an article from the New York Times about you. They call you one of your generation's most promising writers.
Thank you for showing me this. What shall we read today? I found a very interesting short story by Hemingway, if you're up for it.
Don't you want to read the rest of the article? They practically rave about your work. They say you could be the next great American novelist.
Alan, I've told you, that part of my life is over. I made a choice not to pursue my writing. I'm sorry if it's a choice you don't agree with, but this is my life, and I have a right to choose what I want to do with it. And what I want to do right now is read Hemingway.
Esther.
The hills across the valley of Ebro were long and white. On this side, there was no shade.
Don't shut him out, Esther.
And no trees, and the station between two lines of rails in the sun. Close against the station, there was the warm shadow.
Esther.
Alan, I told you.
No, this isn't about that. What do you read about?
People. I think every good writer should know how to write about people. Characters from real life.
Well, how do you write about something that's so personal?
Well, not everything I write is personal. But some of it is. I write about places I've been, people I've known, people I've loved, people I've hated, people I've lost. And sometimes I write about things I've never heard of, people I made up.
Is that why you don't want to publish your stories? Because you're afraid to let the public read about people you've known?
Alan,
I just want to know.
Alan, I've lived here long time. I don't have any family. At least not any family that's willing to acknowledge me. But living here has been a blessing. I have time to read and to think and to live without the pressures of the real world. My characters, the characters I create, they are more real to me than most people I've known. They are my family. And I'm old and selfish and not willing to share my family with the rest of the world. Can you please accept that for me? Now, where was I?
Here. Let me. There was a warm shadow of the building and a curtain made of strings and bamboo beads hung across the open door into the bar.
Alan.
Yes?
Thank you.
For what?
For being my friend.
I'm across the open door into the bar to keep the flies out. The American and the girl with him sat at a table in the shade outside the building. It was very hot and Esther? Esther, I wrote.
Are you looking for Miss Jeffrey?
Yes. Did they move her?
I'm afraid Miss Jeffrey passed away last night in her sleep. They say she went very peaceful.
Oh.
Were you close to Miss Jeffrey?
Yes.
I'm sorry for your loss. I'll give you a moment alone. You aren't Alan. Are you?
Yes.
I found these in Miss Jeffrey's drawer. They have your name on them.
What stories?
Our stories.
What's
going to
happen?
Let them read them.
It was 1987. I was on the red-eye flight to Miami, Florida.
The plane sat on the runway for 2 hours as the summer shower unleashed its wrath on us. The rain slid down the reinforced glass, slipping and sliding like shooting stars. The captain's voice came on over the intercom system.
Once upon a time,
there was a little girl with chocolate brown hair and shiny front teeth. She wasn't a princess or a fairy or an elf, but she lived in a magical kingdom where anything could happen. One day.
I met Charlie at the spring formal at Westbrook High in 1955.
I wasn't attending the dance. Charlie and his friends flocked to happiness. Not to join it, more to annihilate.
The 1920s came and went.
Like an aimless cat, frisky and graceful and deadly. Claws sharpened to draw in the youth of America. Louise was one of those sacrificed to the materialistic machine.
My father
was a journalist. He was a journalist before I was born, he was a journalist after I was born. But for one damp winter's day in 1937, he was a daddy.
One day, Ruby decided she wanted to explore the mysterious forest. She packed two loaves of bread and a bright red satchel and set off towards the woods.
He assured us that we would be taking off soon. And while you wait, he said, I'm going to sing for you. His voice joined with the glorious beating of the rain, creating a rhythmic symphony, a calming orchestra.
Louise was a flapper, an independent, selfish girl who wore short skirts and even shorter hair.
Charlie owned a car, a turquoise blue Cadillac. He and his friends used to race it up and down the street, enjoying the power, the respect that it granted them.
My father was a journalist. He used to say that the day I was born, he almost gave up being it. He said I was the only one who could steal his heart.
When we reached Florida, the captain saw us all off the plane, personally.
The evil witch told Ruby she would ask her three questions.
And so that stoic, selfish, intoxicated girl fell in love.
Charlie stared at me. His eyes blinking back the rain, or his tears, I couldn't tell.
When I was 7 years old, my father flew to New York to see a UN briefing.
So with a flower in hand, she returned home.
The 30s brought about the end of the golden years, and the end of Louise.
My heart goes out to that man, that unknown man, who sacrificed so much.
And with Chuck Berry blasting from the radio, Charlie drove away forever.
I would get to know my father as a journalist much later, but for that summer, he was just a dad.
The end. Are these your stories?
Yes.
Esther could see you, couldn't she?
Yes.
She's not coming back, is she? If she's really dead, how come you're still here? How come I can see you?
Because she created us. She wrote our stories down. We have the ability to exist forever. And now we exist in you.
You have to go too, don't you?
Yeah.
Alan?
Yes?
Alan, will you write our stories?
But
she left them here for you, Alan. She left them with your name on it. She left them here for you, and we want you to publish them.
Will you?